Welcome to Perlman Quadrangle and Irvine Auditorium. Irvine Auditorium is a non-smoking facility. Restrooms are located on the lower and second balcony levels. Vending machines and payphones are located only on the lower level. Assisted listening devices are available upon request. Please take time to note the exit clearly marked at the front and rear of the auditorium. If for some reason there is an emergency, please use these exits to vacate the building in an orderly fashion. For your safety and the safety of others, after exiting, please move away from the building as far as possible. Cameras or recording devices are not permitted in the auditorium. Please take the time now to silence all cell phones or beepers for thorough enjoyment of today's presentation by yourself and others.
Welcome to today's program. Please welcome University of Pennsylvania President, Dr. Amy Gutmann.
Great to see you. Wonderful to see you. Wow. Whoa. Welcome. Welcome. So, today we will enjoy a conversation with one of our nation's foremost statesman, and now also the inaugural Benjamin Franklin Practice Professor at the University of Pennsylvania. How's that? And one of the, actually the preeminent leader of a center of global engagement and diplomacy. Literally, the leader of the Penn Biden Center for Diplomacy and Global Engagement. If there ever were a person who needed no introduction, he's the one. So, please join me in offering a very warm welcome to our nation and Penn's very own Honorable Joe Biden.
Hey, buddy. Good to see you all. Thank you. And no, I did not know Ben Franklin, in case you're wondering.
So, Mr. Vice President, I'm going to tee this off with a few questions and leave a lot of questions for our audience. So let me begin, and I'm going to focus on the subject matter of the Penn Biden Center. So it is well known that you have spent maybe more one-on-one hours with China's President Xi than any other American, certainly, maybe any other world leader. What is your impression, what's your understanding of President Xi's approach? What does he want from China's role in the world today? And also, what is his view of US-China relations? And if you could also say what your view is, how does your view compare with his?
Well, let me begin by saying that it's great to be here. Now, it really is. It's great to be here as a part of Penn, not paying tuitions. I had two kids go here and two grandchildren here, and so I'm delighted. But all kidding aside, it's an honor to be here, and you all have an A, as far as I'm concerned. Well, Madam President, I've always joked, President Obama and I have become very close friends, as you probably, notwithstanding the memes, God, some of them are funny. But anyway, and no, I'm not wearing his bracelet. But he is a very close friend, and I like him a lot. The president always this kid from the beginning, when people ask him about our relationship, he said, Joe's like a big brother. He can tell me things no one else can tell me, and I know he'll always have my back. And it works the other way around as well. And I have a tendency to try to teach or to make my point known by telling stories, because I think it's the best way to communicate. I find myself often quoting my dad or my grandpa or my mom, because they had a lot of wisdom. And I've been saying to the president since we started running together almost now going on 9.5 years ago, that Tip O'Neill, the famous Speaker of the House, was a good friend and mentor of mine, who said all politics is local. I said, I'm getting old enough that I can improve on his statement. All politics is personal. All international politics is personal. And so the president took that to heart when we had a state visit for the former president of China, President Hu. And we had a state dinner, and the vice president with him was Xi Jinping. And it was obvious Xi Jinping was the heir apparent. And the president suggested, the two presidents suggested that Xi Jinping and I should get to know one another and spend time together. And I believe I've spent more time with Xi Jinping alone than any world leader, period. I've had over, the State Department chronicles this, I've had over 25 hours of private dinners with him, just he and I, and each with an interpreter, from Chengdu to Washington to San Francisco to Beijing. And he's an interesting guy. He is part of what they call, those of you who are involved in China studies, the princelings. The princelings are that group of children and grandchildren of the founders of the Communist China, who have a very elite status and a elite place in the Chinese society. And he's also, obviously, because of that, a powerful member of the Communist Party. And so when he came to power, he realized he was going to have some incredibly difficult choices that he had to make, that were not all likely to turn out well. I'm a lover of poetry, and particularly Irish poetry, and one of my favorite poets is Seamus Heaney. And he wrote a poem called The Cure at Troy. And he talks about hope and history rhyming, but the more accurate poem is not so much about how we're gonna rhyme hope and history from the mind, from the perspective of Xi Jinping, but a line from Yeats, in the poem Easter Sunday, 1916. He said, all has changed utterly. A terrible beauty has been born. All has changed in the world and in China in the last 2 decades. And a terrible beauty has been born. And China has enormous, enormous, enormous internal problems that it has to deal with. There's been no circumstance where you've moved into a demand economy, a capitalist economy that has any, and a growing middle class, where eventually the middle class hasn't demanded more control over their lives. It's never happened. It's never been sustained. Well, the Faustian bargain that's been made in China thus far has been, we'll let you grow economically, we'll let you move into a accomplish living in a two-bedroom apartment or a one-bedroom apartment, we'll let your economic standard grow, but we continue to control your life, the party. And that is never really able to be, has never been sustained thus far. And so he has enormous pulls on him. He has an internal circumstance where the millennial generation wants China to be able to act on the world stage consistent with what it appears to be its prowess and its power. But China doesn't have the ability to do that. They don't have the ability to project force. They don't have a navy. It'll take them 17 years and about $9 trillion just to get to the place where the United States is now. China not only doesn't have enough energy, it doesn't have enough water, literally enough water. There's a $2 trillion project in contemplation to redirect the direction of the two major rivers in China to the population centers. Significant portion of China's arable land has been polluted by cadmium. They have to create 9 million jobs a year, and they have to be jobs, middle-class jobs, to meet expectations. And so after spending all this time with President Xi, and I've spent a lot of time subsequent to him becoming president, I was asked by President Obama when I came back from Chengdu with him, he said, what's he like? I said, he has the look of a man about to take on a job he knows is not going to end well. I'm not being facetious. Yeah. And so the end result is what he's trying to figure out, in my view, Madam President, he's trying to figure out what is China's role in the world and how can China move into that world? And China is, I believe he's going to be very patient. I believe he is not going to attempt to rush China's role in the world, and he's going to feel his way through an awful lot of what has to happen. But my view of China's role is that our relationship, it's the single most consequential relationship for us to develop for your generation, number one. Number two, it has to be a relationship built on responsible competition, they have to be responsible stakeholders. And when they're neither responsible in either of those areas, we have to call it out. We have to make it clear. We have a lot more leverage in the relationship than they do, a lot more leverage. I'll conclude by saying he asked me why I keep saying, this is 3 years ago, why I keep saying the United States is a Pacific power. And I said, it's a Pacific power. I say that because we are a Pacific power. And Mr. President, your stability would not exist but for us projecting power in the Pacific, particularly in the Northeast Pacific. And he looked at me and he said, I understand, I know. Because we are the fulcrum of what everything else moves. But there's some really difficult problems we don't have time to discuss now. But whether it's Korea, the relationship with Japan, an emerging India and what that relationship will be. And the concluding point I'll make is that we are making, I think, a tragic mistake right now. And the liberal world order has delivered enormous benefits to the United States of America, more than any other country in the world. And with us stepping back in this last election, with us stepping back from international trade and being the arbiters of what the rules of international trade will be, and us now stepping back from environmental leadership, we are about to forfeit an opportunity to have phenomenally positive impact, not only in China, but the rest of the world. But that's for another, that's for a seminar.
So, there you go. All of this will be for seminars to come, right? So let me move to another part of the world about which I'm sure you wouldn't say the leader is patient, and that is Russia. You have spent, I'll ask you a question that enables you to expand on that. You have spent a great deal of time as vice president, a great deal of time and attention to Russia, to Eastern Europe, and particularly the Ukraine, particularly the independence and stability of the Ukraine. Russia appears to be asserting a renewed sphere of influence in the region, and U.S.-Russia relationships are, to say the least, challenging. So I'm going to just ask you straight up, what can and should be done vis-a-vis Russia?
I've known every Russian leader since 1972. My academic interest, as well as my interest for years and years of being chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, was, to the extent that I had any expertise, was Europe and Russia. And so I have negotiated with everyone from Kosygin when he was there as foreign minister to recently with Putin. And Putin has, we thought after Yeltsin that we had reached an agreement in Europe, the possibility of a Europe whole, free, and secure, with its international boundaries honored and maintained. Putin came along and he concluded that wasn't in Russia's interest. Russia is a declining power, which makes it very dangerous. Its population is declining. It's down 145 million people. They were a nation of over 300 million people. Of the Russian Federation, a significant portion is an Islamic portion of the nation, completely disassociated with it and in internal conflict with the Russian population. It has nothing to sell but raw materials, and it doesn't have the technical know-how how to maintain and deal with that wealth that they have. It needs the West. And so Putin has decided, for a number of reasons I don't have time to go into, Putin has decided that the best place for Russia to be is for the international order to break up. He is not strong enough, nor does he think Russia is strong enough, to be able to reestablish the Soviet Union. That's not what this is about. I asked my staff, I asked the man who's going to head this up here for me, Steve Ricchetti, whether we can make sure online is the speech I just made at Davos with Xi Jinping about, in Switzerland, about the threat Russia poses and what we should be doing. But Russia, Putin has concluded that it's better to see a Europe fractured and democratic institutions fractured so that all he has to deal with in the region is medium-sized powers with which he can deal and or intimidate, or see their economies collapse. It is not in his interest. It's in the interest of his people, not in his interest, to see Europe thrive. And so what you're seeing going on now is an attempt, in my view, to undermine the post-World War II institutions, from NATO to the more recent one, the Maastricht Treaty, and which is the European Union. That's what this is all about, because he doesn't have to then deal with a united Europe that presents a significant obstacle to his meddling and his illegal actions. And he's having some little success now.
Can he succeed?
He can succeed if we're not smart. And that's where it comes in. The United States of America has to lead the world. We must be engaged. As Madeleine Albright said, we are the essential nation. And it's not a bravado born out of that. I wish in some senses we weren't. But we have to now look, the reason why we've been able to lead the world is not merely because we have the most powerful military in the history of the world. And that's not hyperbole. It is by far, in a way, the most powerful military in the history of the world. No one is close. But the reason we're followed is not because of the power, the example of our power, but the power of our example, our value set. That's what has been able to persuade the world to move in the directions that we've wanted it to move. And what worries me most now, and I'll end with this, what worries me most is we have a president now who's the first president I am aware of, I may be wrong about this, but the first president I've been aware of who never has used the phrase American values. Think about it. Assignment. Find me any place he's ever used the phrase American values. Every other president has talked in terms of American values, because American values are what we've been propagating. They relate to democracy, to human rights, to economic opportunity, to growth, to collaboration. And so if he's able to continue to break that sense of our obligation, then I think he has a chance of making it more difficult. But as they used to say in little old Claymont, Delaware, not from far from here, Russia is not a patch on our genes, but they can cause us a lot of trouble.
Let me ask you a follow-up on that. You raised it. In the current, and this brings American politics together with foreign policy and the world, the global peace and prosperity of the world order. So in the current political environment, it seems that the preservation of American jobs, which of course is very important, having American people be able-bodied Americans be able to work, that is being pitted against what you've called and we've all called American values, promulgating human rights and democracy in the world. How do you see this, is there in fact a tension between preserving American jobs and making employment real for Americans?
It's and a false choice.
So how do you, what are some of the facts that suggest that to you, and how do you communicate that? Because what's being communicated seems to be we have to choose, right, between preserving American jobs and engaging with in the world with proudly with American values.
Well, look, first of all, I think that choice is exaggerated. No.
It was only a matter of time, folks.
Look, in a sense, we wouldn't be having this conversation about American jobs in the way it's just been phrased legitimately by the president were not for 171,000 votes. 171,000 votes in four states put us in this position. And I think that what happened was that this is the first campaign that I can recall where my party did not talk about what it always stood for, and that is how to maintain a burgeoning middle class. And the truth of the matter is you didn't hear a single solitary sentence in the last campaign about that guy working on the assembly line making $60,000 a year and the wife making $32,000 as a hostess in a restaurant, and they making $90,000, they got two kids and they can't make it. And they're scared. They're frightened. Because they're not stupid. Globalization has not been an unalloyed benefit for everybody. It's left a lot of people behind. On balance, in a macroeconomic sense, it's been a phenomenal success lifting millions and millions of people out of poverty. But it's left a lot of people behind. And there's answers to how we sustain this global system, which we badly need more than any other country in the world. And at the same time, make sure people aren't left behind. For example, if, hey, baby, how are you? This is my niece. How are you? Give me a kiss. How are you? I didn't even see you there.
The Biden family's everywhere.
Sorry.
Penn vet.
She's a Penn vet. And,
Let's hear it for Penn vet, folks.
Most doctors I know go to medical school because they can't get into veterinary school. It's awful hard up here to get in. But at any rate, where was I? For example, if you're married and have two children and live in Philadelphia, and you're a professional woman, it's going to cost you $22,000 to $24,000 a year for childcare. Period. Not a joke. That's what it costs in major cities across America. If you're in a situation where you are trying to send your kid to Penn or to any private school, but let alone a private school, to a state school, it's an enormous cost. Colleges are pricing. Actually, it may be easier to pay to get to Penn because Penn has the ability and an endowment to help people who can't otherwise afford it. But try to go to my alma mater, the University of Delaware. It's hard. It's hard to pay. And secondly, people look out there and they say, wait a minute, the world is really changing, man. Because with digitalization, I just made a speech at Davos and one just the other day down in Washington about the fourth industrial revolution. Digitalization is moving so rapidly, that whether you're an astrophysicist or you're working on an assembly line, you're going to need to be reeducated in the next 5 years. What you know now will not sustain you 5 years from now. And people intuitively know that, and they're scared to death. So instead of talking about their fears and letting them know there are answers without abandoning our place in the world for our own safety's sake, we didn't talk about it. It never came up, if you think about it. It never came up. And so, you know, all those angry white men, you know, we talk about that are racist. Guess what? Barack and I won them. Let's get this straight. It wasn't racist. They voted for a black man twice in a row. But they didn't this time. They didn't this time. Because they look out there and they're scared and no one's talking to them. And my dad used to have an expression. He said, "Joey, I don't expect the government to solve my problem, but I sure and hell expect them to understand my problem." So how much time do we spend talking about the problem? You realize with the highest rate of suicide, the highest rate of opioid addiction, the highest rate of divorce is among white boys 45 to 55. Not in the ghetto, not in the barrio, white boys 45 to 55. Because they think they're being thrown on the industrial slab heap, that there's nothing going to be nothing for them to do. And that's not true. It's not true. But we don't talk about it. So it goes back to this idea about jobs. The answer to our jobs is for us to continue to engage the world and insist on fair trade. Now look at the promises that have just been made. The truth of the matter is, this fellow has not created any jobs. He's not going to create many jobs. The 20,000 jobs he talked about, 20,000 jobs he just talked about creating from the communications company, they were created and announced by us before we left. No, but I mean, and by the way, the pipeline, you know how many permanent jobs that's going to create? 35. Coal country. You know how many jobs we created in alternative energy in the last 5 years? 455,000. You know how many coal mining jobs there are? 62,000. And by the way, but we don't deal with those people losing their jobs the right way. I come from Scranton. I was a kid when it was dying. Not a joke. I watched it. You could feel it when I go home from Wilmington. Everything changed, and it wasn't just they lost their jobs, they lost a way of life. When you're a miner, you worship the same way. You marry in the same churches. It's an ecosystem, it's a cultural ecosystem. And it's being broken up. And some of the Democrats, on one hand, say, well, that's just the way it is. Give me a break, the way it is. It's a reality, it's changing, so what do we do to cushion that change? Provide alternative opportunities. But so this idea of watch the job creation. Like I said, the whole pipeline, only people making money in the pipeline are the Canadians and the Russians. That's Canadian-Russian steel, not U.S. steel. Go down the list of all the promises. Tariffs are going to be thrown up in Mexico and Canada. Show me. Show me. So, folks, it's getting back to talking rationally and reasonably. And it starts with you guys. I'm not being facetious when I say that. You're the intellectual gravamen of your generation. And it's about playing. It's like I always kid my staff, and I kid them, they get mad at me. I say, speak English to me, not as opposed to Spanish, as opposed to complicated. I really mean it. So it is not, it's a false choice. You didn't ask the question, but there's another false choice. The false choice that my party's going through now. Whether or not we're more progressive or we focus on working class white people. Mm-hmm. Give me a break. I take a backseat to no one who served in Congress for the past 40 years in terms of my progressive record. I was there 36 years, and I've been rated by some of these agencies that I don't know how they come up with a rating as the third or fifth most liberal member to serve during that entire period. I take a backseat to nobody, but guess what? All those middle-class guys and women vote for me. There's no inconsistency. In this last campaign, to make a point, so we try to change our views, I'd go into Lorain, Ohio, or I'd go into the Valley, I'd go into Pittsburgh, I'd go into on automobile plants, and I'd start off and say, you know what? We need equal pay for women. Right? And we should legislate it. Well, guess what? All those white boys, labor guys, stood up and cheered. You know why? Why you're so dumb? Why you don't understand why? Because their wives work. It's their standard of living. But listen to so-called liberals like me, and it's, well, you know, they really don't appreciate it. This is something that has to do with their sexism. Come on, man. It just drives me crazy as you, I don't get emotional about this. But look, I'll end and go to your rest of your questions. I'll answer yes or no the rest of them. Guys, I am more optimistic about the prospects for the United States of America and your generation than I have been any time in my career. That is not hyperbole. That is not hyperbole. We are better positioned by a mile than any other nation in the world to own the 21st century, than any nation in the world. If we just get out of our way, if we just start talking about and dealing with the values and the realities of what we possess, it's enormous, the resources we have here, enormous.
I may have to get up to ask you my final question. No. Or you can... I'm happy to get up. So you actually totally alluded to it, but I think it's a really important question for us to end on, and then I'm going to segue to your questions, which I have right here. And the question is, you've spent almost 40 years in the Senate and then 8 years as vice president, and you could teach a heck of a master class on reaching across the aisle, sponsoring and succeeding in bipartisan legislation. It is, if anyone knows one thing now about Washington when they say it's broke, is that there are few and far between bipartisan deals being made. Can we fix it? What is needed? What did you learn that worked? I remember, I just have to say, I was so taken when I was at Arlen Specter's funeral in the middle of a presidential campaign. You were campaigning, you dropped everything, and you came and gave the major eulogy for Arlen. And I remember how moving that was to so many people, because that was not a one, you and Arlen were really good friends and did a lot together for NIH funding and other things. So how do we get that happening again? What have you learned that would help? And what could people here, our students, do to help that happen?
What I learned is what you guys already know. It's all about understanding human nature. I mean, it really isn't that complicated. Think of the people that you know and respect. What do they do first and foremost? They treat you with respect, and everyone's entitled to be treated with dignity. They treat people that way. That's number one. Number two, they they always, one way or another, basically try to put themselves in your spot. You know, what they do is, and you do it, those of you who are good at it, you think, okay, if I were her, she, or I were him, what would I be thinking about what I'm about to say or do? How are my words, how do they land on his ears or her ears? And I received 3, quote, prestigious awards this last year for, and it was kind of sad, actually. I'm not being facetious. I got the highest award a Catholic university can give at Notre Dame because of my bipartisanship. I got an award, Allegheny College has now had this award that's now become very famous about bipartisanship, and was given to John McCain and me, and we hollered at each other. And I just got an award from the largest bipartisan organization in the country, set up by 2 former majority leaders, Democrat and Republican, 1,000 people there. And I start off by saying, this is sad that I am getting an award for what was expected when I started. And there's 3 things. Number one, no matter what you go and do, no matter what profession you pursue, no matter what your objective is, it really matters to get to know your competition, get to know the person who you view as your problem, as well as your friend, to figure out what makes them tick, to understand what their limits are, that may be limits that you, in fact, would understand they couldn't go beyond if you were in their situation. Try to understand the place from which they come. 2, never question their motive, because you don't know their motive. I've told, Amy's heard me use this before, but it's the best example I can give. When I first got to the Senate, my wife and daughter had been killed, and my 2 boys were hospitalized, very badly injured, and I didn't want to go. So I wouldn't go down and be sworn in. So they sent the Senate Sergeant of Arms telling me up to the hospital where my boys were and swore me in. And I said I'd come for 6 months. And a wonderful, wonderful, brilliant old guy named Mike Mansfield was the majority leader. And he had me come to his office every Tuesday at 3:00. And he'd give me an assignment. I thought every Senate, I was 29 years old, I just turned 30. I thought every senator got an assignment. No senators get assignments. No. I'm the first senator ever knew. I didn't know that. So one day I'm walking over. It took me about 2 months to figure out. He was just basically taking my pulse to see how I was doing, caring about me. And I walked on the Senate floor one day. If you ever watch C-SPAN, those double doors that open, you go down to the well of the Senate and you vote. Because I'd always go by before I went over and to my meeting. His office was on the other side of the chamber, to check when the last vote would be so I could get an Amtrak and come home and see my boys. And I walked in one day, it was the end of May, and Jesse Helms, who was a segregationist senator from North Carolina, who was really a rough guy, was excoriating 2 friends of mine. One, Republican leader, Bob Dole, who's still my friend I keep in touch with, God love me, he's in a wheelchair and really showing a lot of courage. And Teddy Kennedy's passed away. And they had introduced the precursor for the Americans with Disabilities Act. And he was excoriating them for it's not the role of the government, or you cannot demand people have to have curb cuts or lifts into buses. It's not government's role to make it easier for the handicapped, et cetera. And I was outraged. But because I had the meeting, I kept going. I walked in, I sat in front of Senator Mansfield's desk. And he looked at me, always spoke in clipped tones. He said, "What's the matter, Joe?" And I went on for a couple minutes about Jesse Helms having no social redeeming value. I couldn't. No, I really was. I was really angry. How could he feel that way? How could he be so heartless? How could he, he is just a selfish so-and-so? And he looked at me. My word is true story. He looked at me, he said, "Joe, what would you say if I told you that Dot Helms, his wife, and Jesse, in the Christmas of 1970, were sitting in their home in Raleigh, reading the Raleigh Observer. And there was an advertisement of a young man, a picture of him, in steel braces up to his hips, both legs, and steel crutches, bent over, 14 years old, saying, "All I want for Christmas is someone to love me and take me home." I said, "What would you say, Joe, if I told you Jesse and Dot Helms adopted that young man?" Which they did. I said, "I'd feel like a fool." He said, "Well, Joe, they did." He said, "I've learned a long time ago, never question another man or woman's motive, because you don't know what the motive is. And once you question their motive, you can never reach an agreement with them. You can never get to yes. It's always appropriate to question their judgment. Holler and fight like hell about it. You can always get to a position where you can reach an agreement. But what do we do today? It's all motive. You're bad. You're immoral. You're in the pocket of. You're this. You're that." And it's changed. And the third thing that's changed is we used to know one another in the Congress, in the Senate. By that, I mean we ate lunch together. We traveled together, Democrats and Republicans. If I know your dad is dying of cancer, and you and I are at odds, completely opposite end on tax policy or foreign policy, it's harder not to like you because I see the suffering in your eyes. If you know that I have a son or a daughter, when you get to know someone, it's hard to genuinely dislike them, to let your ideology overtake your relationship with them. Doesn't mean your ideology is going to change. But it's easier. So we used to have a private dining room for senators. One, I could take you as a guest of mine in tables, about 15, 20 tables. Another one, it was totally private, two great big conference tables in another room across the hall. Just senators could go in, no one else. We used to always go in and sit down and eat with one another, get to know one another, hear each other's stories. I went up there, I keep contact with the members of the Senate, both parties. I went up to I figured I'll just go up and go and just drop in for lunch. I walked in, the tables are gone. There's lounge chairs in there. They don't eat together anymore. They don't travel together anymore. Chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, I traveled all over the world. I'd always make sure that Republicans travel with me and their spouses. They don't do that anymore. They don't know one another anymore. And the fourth thing, and maybe the most pernicious thing that's happened, is the way we fund our elections. Money has corrupted the system. I don't mean people are being bought, but I do mean it matters when Judge Garland, I call 17 Republicans, say, "You know better." 9 of them said to me, "You're right, Joe, but I can't do anything about it. Because if I do, the Koch brothers or somebody's gonna drop $5 million into my race and I'll lose my primary." Not worried about general elections, about primaries. It's radically changed the influence. You wanna change American politics tomorrow? Pass public financing of elections. Then you can. But the bottom line is, Madam President, it's coming back. For example, I got a phone call. I don't think you'd mind my saying. I got a phone call yesterday before I came up here from the guy who's viewed as the toughest negotiator and the meanest Republican. Not a joke. The Majority Leader of the United States Senate, Mitch McConnell. Know why he called me? He wants to know whether I will come and present him an award he's about to get, the Jefferson Award. It's not only not funny, it's really good. Yeah. Because he completely trusts me. We totally disagree. Mm-hmm. But guess what? Because we respect each other, with 4 days left to go in the United States Congress, I was able to get $6.4 billion for brain research and cancer. Even though every conservative think tank in the country said, no, don't do it. It got 387 votes in the House and 89 in the Senate. Because they knew better. And they knew that I'd do it for them if it was the right thing. It matters. It matters. How many really brilliant people do you know? And I'm not being solicited, a lot of brilliant people, students as well as professors here at this university. How many brilliant people do you know who are really stupid? Not a joke. I mean, really stupid in the way they do things. So this is not hard. And it's coming back. It's coming back. And the way it's going to come back is you saw it in the vote on health care. They've screwed up the courage to do what they thought was the right thing to do, notwithstanding threats. Because the Democrats are the same way, by the way. I'm not saying this is all Republicans. It's just the nature of the way the political system has devolved, not evolved, devolved over the last 10 years. And I think it can come back.
We agreed we'd leave half the time for these wonderful
questions. I'll stay as long as you want.
So, right, there you go. So, you stand. You like standing, I'll do it. So, this is from a student, Darren Ashby. Darren, are you here somewhere?
Darren left a long time
okay,
ago.
Okay, no, there he is. He's right there. So, which part of the world receives less attention from the American public than it should?
Central America. I believe Central America is the second most critical part of the world for U.S. interest for a whole range of reasons. And that's why the president would blithely do things with me. That's why we were sitting in a national security meeting one day. Tony was there, and he turned to me and said, Tony Blinken,
Tony
Deputy
Blinken.
Secretary of State, who's now up here with me at Penn.
He's now part of our Penn-Biden Center. Tony, where are you? Tony, stand up. Come on, stand up.
I think you were there in the Oval the day. He said, Joe, you do the hemisphere. And I said, do the hemisphere, huh? You know, he said, it's the same time zone. You make friends easily. But remember when they had that rush of unaccompanied children at the border a couple years ago and all the crisis? So we were able to put together, I was able to get the Latin American presidents together, and we were able to put together a $1 billion program to begin to help them rebuild their economies. Because the one way to keep folks from not leaving their countries is to have something for them in their countries. Do you know one of the greatest misconception about immigrants is that, and one of the reasons we're so strong and so powerful as a nation, is we've been able to cherry pick the best of every culture. And the reason is that people don't sit around and go, you know, want to be a good idea? Let's sell everything we have, give it to a criminal gang or a coyote, and have them smuggle us into a country where we don't speak the language, drop us off and say goodbye. Won't that be fun? Let's go. No, I'm serious. I'm not joking. Think about it. Think about it. The people who choose to come are people who are the most optimistic. People who choose to come are the most imaginative. The people who choose to come have the most fortitude. The people who used to come, I go down the list, whether it's my Irish ancestors or your Hispanic ancestors or whomever it was. And so this is a place where we should be paying a lot more attention, because it also, there is not a reason why in the 21st century the Western Hemisphere should be the epicenter of economic growth in the world. It has everything. For the first time in human history, you can look from the Arctic down to the archipelago and see an entire hemisphere that is democratic, middle class, and at peace. Mm-hmm. It's within our power to have that happen. And the economic growth that is possible and the jobs that are available for Americans in this hemisphere is enormous. We don't pay nearly much attention, but I better not get going and telling you what we should do, but we're longer.
There you go. Anne McGonigal. Anne is a graduate student. Anne, are you here? There, right here, Anne. Okay. Joe, if you could give President Trump one piece of advice, what would it be?
Grow up. Look, I shouldn't be so flip, but I mean that in substantial part because, look, in fairness to President Trump, I don't believe President Trump ever thought he was going to be President Trump. No. I'm not being facetious, okay? I'm being deadly earnest. I don't think he thought he was going to be. A lot of, by the way, he supported me for the United States Senate. He contributed, you know. So it's not like, you know, I don't think he thought he was going to be. And I think that by the time it got around to realizing he just might win, he had not taken the time, which every other winning and losing candidate in my lifetime has done. And that is put together a transition team. So he knew what he was going to at least try to do the day after he won, if he won, even if it was a 3-1 shot of winning. And they spent a lot of time doing that. And so he was at an enormous disadvantage when he won. For example, I know Mike Pence. I get on well with Mike. I don't agree with him, particularly on the social policy, but I don't agree with Mike. But he's a decent guy. And so the first thing I did when Mike won is I called him and said, Mike, I'm here. Anything you want, my staff's available to you, my national security staff, et cetera. And I started laying out for him a whole range of things from Ukraine, which I didn't respond to your question on, to all the way to, you know, all the way it was going on in on the Paris Agreement. Mm-hmm. And the problem was, I was unable to, my staff, and then my national security advisor, Colin Call, who is a tenured professor at Georgetown, a smart guy, he was prepared to meet with his people. But Mike didn't even have anybody that was clear that we could meet with. And so I would write these memoranda, and I'd get them to Mike directly because I wasn't able to give them to him, there was no staff. I don't know if they're still this way, Tony, but I was told that at least 3 weeks ago, you could walk down the halls of the State Department and holler and no one would hear you. I mean, no, I'm being a bit facetious, but but by the way, not very. One of the reasons I predict to you there will be no tax bill. There's not enough people in the Treasury Department to handle the calculations and the strategy for that. Not a joke. They haven't appointed them. They're not appointed. And so I think that it's, you know, I would literally, presumptuous of me to advise the president, but I would literally, you know, stop tweeting. No, and start focusing, because this does not, it does not. Let me conclude this. The words of a president matter. They have enormous, enormous, enormous reverberating sounds around the world. Every time a president speaks and says something, leaders and people around the world try to dissect, what does he mean? Because it matters so much to their security, their threats they think they face, whatever it is. And so you can't loosely make assertions without limiting your ability to lead.
Terrific. Frank Brummel, Penn Law. Frank, right there. Go ahead. There's at least one fan of Penn Law here. Let's hear more. We got a lot of fans here. Important question. These are great questions. With fewer veterans in society and in elite institutions like Congress, how do we get the public to understand and care about the use of force? I'm going to sit down and let you.
What's the first name? What's his first name?
Oh, Frank.
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 Frank, there's fewer veterans, but there's more combat veterans and families. Only 1% of the population has done the fighting, but tens and tens of thousands of folks around the country understand the sacrifice. And this generation of warriors has done more than any generation in history in terms of what's been asked of them. Repeated deployments, repeated sacrifices, overwhelming burden on them. And what has been, what people are aware of is that there is a emerging, so far not debilitating, but there's been an emerging, actually it's emerged 6-7 years ago, real skepticism for the use of force without a plan as to how it ends. And so there is a real feeling in the Congress and the Senate, and there's a fair number now of emerging number of vets of the Iraq and Afghan wars that are engaged now in public life. And so I don't think it has led, matter of fact, they are probably as likely to continue to argue for engagement in maintaining the international order than other generations have. So although there's not as many, and there haven't been, even during the Vietnam period, there were not many Vietnam vets when I got there in the middle of the Vietnam War. I ran to stop the war, to be part of the effort to stop the war. There weren't many Vietnam vets. There were notable ones and become my great, great friends. And I didn't have to convince the president to appoint cabinet positions like Chuck Hagel and John Kerry and others. But there's never been, since World War II, a large cadre of people holding public office in the House and the Senate who were actually veterans. I think there is a real sense and a real genuine skepticism, not a withdrawal, but a skepticism of your generation as to the use of force. What are the basic rationale for the use of force, and in what circumstances should it be used? And I'm not so worried that it's your generation that's going to say, "Let's come home." I'm worried that the generation that is being left behind economically will be convinced that. The percentage of the American people being left behind economically will say, wait a minute, us being engaged abroad is the reason why I'm not doing well at home. I could be wrong, but that's my view.
Mr. Rice, can I ask you just a follow-up on that? Because you've been such a champion of veterans and are not just honoring them, but actually helping them with everything they need. Is that something that you feel, again, on a bipartisan basis, that we could do as a country better than we've done? Because we have so many, there's so many veterans who have done so much for our country, and you know this very personally. It's so important as part of American values that we honor and support them.
Well, A long time ago, I got in trouble in my party for saying that we have a lot of obligations to the poor, the underprivileged, to those with disabilities, et cetera. But we only have one sacred obligation. The only sacred obligation we have is to those we send to war and their families when they come home or don't come home. That's a sacred obligation in my view. And my wife, who used to be 9 years younger than me, is now 25 years younger than me. But we bracketed the Vietnam generation. You know, the Tet Offensive is when I graduated from law school, and when Vietnam vets were coming home in the Philadelphia airport being spat upon in 1972 was when she was in college. So we determined that, as a family, that we would never, ever, ever see to it that this group of warriors were treated like the Vietnam generation of warriors. And the public hasn't done that. They've embraced them. Yeah. How many times you been in a plane when a deployed group get on the plane, everybody claps and stands up in the plane? Because they know the sacrifices they're making. One of the reasons why the problem with the VA occurred is a little bit my fault. I fought my whole career for getting coverage for my generation's veterans who were drenched with acid rain in Vietnam. But the military would not cover them, over 300,000 of them. And because they couldn't prove the autoimmune disease they were suffering from the rest of their life was directly caused by acid rain. And so with Tony's help, when we were in the Senate, there were two things we were able to do. One, I got passed legislation saying that if anyone came home with a traumatic brain injury and all they had to prove was they were in the area where there was concussion, that's all they had to prove. They didn't have to prove that it was caused by that. That's all they had to prove. And it was assumed that that's why they had traumatic brain injury. And then we finally threw in that generation of mine that was still left that, in fact, were the victims of acid rain. And that swelled immediately the ranks of all the people eligible for health care and overtook the system a while. We're short about 600,000 registered nurses in the United States today. We're short psychiatric nurses. We're short an awful lot of things that we need. Over 300,000 people came home from Iraq and Afghanistan with unseen injuries, post-traumatic stress and or traumatic brain injury. And so it's put an awful stress that we weren't prepared for, but it's working now, but it's our obligation. And Stiglitz, a famous economist, pointed out that your generation is going to have somewhere around a $9 billion bill that's gonna last the rest of your lives. And the reason is, and you better damn well pay it. And the reason is that of 70% of those wounded in Afghanistan and Iraq, if they had the exact same wound in Vietnam, they would have died. But because of the triage capability and what they call the golden hour, the commitment we made to get mortally wounded soldiers to a major trauma facility within 1 hour, and then fly them all the way to Landstuhl over 10 hours, they're living. But many of them are gonna need intensive care the rest of their lives. More amputees in this war than any other war since the Civil War because of IEDs and a whole range of other things. We've committed to them, they'll have the most modern prosthesis the rest of their lives. Not just once, the rest of their lives. And that's an obligation that I think we have to keep, but it's expensive. And I think the American public, if pushed and asked for it and reminded of when the last monument is put up, when the last road is named, when the last parade ends, there's gonna be about 400,000 people are still going to be needing help for a long time.
Caitlin Barlow's staff. Caitlin, are you here? Yeah, right there, Caitlin. Okay. In our current political climate, it at times seems hopeless and our efforts futile. How have you remained positive, and what would you suggest for those just beginning their engagement?
It's a really good question. I'm confident and optimistic because I'm a student of American history. And never, ever, ever, ever have the American people been given an even chance they haven't succeeded and not let their country down.
Any history majors or minors here? Really important.
Well, yeah. let me give you a concrete example. Everybody talks about how bleak and bad things are today. And I think the reason why they're viewed as so bleak is because some of the problems we're facing are so novel and new. They're de novo. We've never faced them before. They may not be worse, but we've never faced them before. I was very nice thing that Eunice Kennedy and her daughter did for me. I was awarded an award after the only man who was ever my only person I've ever had as a political hero, Bobby Kennedy. And there's a big dinner once a year for the Robert Kennedy Award for American Leadership in New York. And I went up and was very flattered to receive the award. And the woman who spoke before me to present the award was a woman you know. She had been the president of the University of Michigan for 10 years.
Yeah.
Really a first rate. She's voted one of the 10 best presidents of colleges in America. And she now heads up the College Presidents Association.
The American Association of Universities. I was the chair who helped appoint her, found her, and she, Mary Sue Coleman, great.
And she really, really is impressive. But she stood up, and it was in the eve, it was following shortly after President Trump was elected. And it was pretty clear she was down about what was going on. And she talked about what a difficult time this was and how much trouble we're in as a nation and the world, et cetera. And I had just planned on saying nice things about Bobby Kennedy. And I listened, and I understood it was plaintive. It was from her heart.
Yeah.
And everyone in the audience, like maybe a lot of you think this way. And I said, you know, I don't look at it that way. Because she wondered whether young people will still get involved, et cetera, and it went on. And I said, you know, when I graduated in 1968, imagine those are your seniors. Imagine if this year the same thing happened when I'm about to describe to you.
Yeah.
In January of that year, after being told there was, quote, light at the end of the tunnel, we're about to end the god-awful Vietnam War, there was an iconic picture you've seen of a South Vietnamese policeman standing in a crowded intersection in the middle of the street in Saigon, blowing the brains out.
Yeah.
Of a person at point blank. Shortly after that, Lyndon Johnson, who coveted the presidency, after one term announced he wasn't going to run again. Shortly after that, while I was waiting in an airport to pick up someone coming from Wilmington in Syracuse, where I went to law school, sitting in the parking lot, the radio came on, Dr. King had just been assassinated. I come out of the civil rights movement. I was one of those young guys who used to sit in and do sit-ins and those things. And then I heard the voice of Bobby Kennedy standing on top of a car in Indiana, preventing a riot from tearing apart Indianapolis. And then shortly after that, the day I walked across the stage, I'd just seen him 4 days earlier, Bobby Kennedy was assassinated as the de facto nominee of the Democratic Party. Assassinated. Not too much long after that, George Wallace, attempted assassination in Eastern Shore, Maryland, paralyzed for life. And not long after that, peaceful demonstration on Kent State, the National Guard, local National Guard, opened fire in broad daylight. Imagine it happened on this campus. a dozen students dead. My generation, the mantra was trust no one over 30, drop out, hate Asbury. Not a joke. But a whole hell of a lot of us jumped in. Mm-hmm. And we changed the world at the time. We ended the war. We finished the beginning of the civil rights movement. We generated real economic growth. We began the significant fight for the environment and the rights of women. We changed. Folks, don't tell me the American people can't handle this. And what my generation faced was not nearly what my father's generation faced in 1941. American people are so much tougher. They're so much more resilient. They're so much more capable. They're so much smarter than we give them credit for. And by the way, the things you have reason to worry about, the environmental movement, equal rights, LGBT rights, civil rights, all those things, he can't turn those back. Mm-hmm. The country has moved. When I came out, I told the president that there were two things I wouldn't do if I agreed to be his vice president. I said, I won't wear any funny hats and I'm not changing my brand. And he knew exactly what the hell I meant. So when I got asked on television, I support marriage based on love, I said, I sure in hell do. And everybody went nuts. No, no, I'm not asking you, but everyone went nuts in the White House, all over. Yeah. And I went in on Monday, and he got up from behind his desk, and he walked over, gave me a hug. He said you weren't going to change your brand. I said, this is the civil rights issue of my day. I'm not going to be quiet. And I said, besides, I've done you all a gigantic favor. The American public's with me. And we had a bet in the White House. Yeah. Yeah. At that moment, 55% of American people had already crossed that line. They already agreed with me. And within a matter of a year, the whole world changed. There's more to change. He can't turn that back. He'll not be able to turn back. He can damage us significantly on the environment. But the American people will not stand for these changes that he's making of deregulating all these things we've had put in place. Promise you, it will not happen. It will not happen. It will not happen.
Will you share with people you told me the one word that you think captures this? Do you remember?
Yeah, well, I was asked by, I think it's real simple to define what it is to be an American. Yeah. And I really mean it. I was in Chengdu with Xi Jinping, and he's a fascinating guy. He'd ask a lot of interesting questions like, do you really control your military? Because, by the way, the Communist Party does not control the military in China. If you know anything of those of you who are Chinese history majors. This is the first guy to actually begin to gain control of the PRC. Do governors really have authority? There are no authorities that governors have in China. That's why what they do is they keep appropriating land. They cannot tax base because what happens is state-owned enterprises have it all. What does the National Security Council do? They never had one before. Whole range of very smart questions. And this night he looked at me and said, can you define America for me? And I said, yeah, I can. And I really mean it. In one word, possibilities. Yep. Possibilities. Unlike any other nation in the world. We're no better or worse, but it's stamped in the DNA of every naturalized as well as native-born American. You've been raised to believe anything is possible here
Because it is. It is. There's no other nation in the world has that attitude. None. Including the closest in terms of culture to us, in my view, is Australia. No place. No place. One of the reasons for that is, in the United States, you never will get in trouble, and unless you went to Catholic grade school like I did, you never got in trouble for challenging orthodoxy. Only country in the world where orthodoxy is viewed as not having any special place. That's why we're so incredible. To make new things, you got to break old things. It's amazing. It's really true. And we are a nation of possibilities. My greatest fear is we lose that sense that anything is possible. Mm-hmm. Because I swear to God, I promise you, it really, your generation is going to see more in the next 10 years than has happened in the last 40 years. You're going to have to bend it to benefit the majority of the people, like every other major revolution has been able to do. By the time my niece has a grandchild or has a child old enough to go to the school, you're going to be able to fly 22,000 miles an hour subsonically. We're going to have cured cancer in most forms. We're going to be in a situation where our ability, we can do now, just in the time that my son, Bo, who's passed away, just in the time he started here to today, we've gone from able to do 10,000 calculations per second to 1,000,000,000 calculations per second. 1,000,000,000 calculations per second. Opening up possibilities that are astronomical, no pun intended. So look, man, this is not a time to be down. This is a time to jump in. This is a time to say, hey, not me. Enough. I'm speaking up. I'm speaking out. But you're going to have to do. You are the most incredible generation. You are the most generous generation in American history. You're the best educated generation in American history. You have involved, you've volunteered more than any generation in American history. You are more open-minded than any generation in American history, but you're also afraid to get involved in the public sphere. So far, you have not, your generation, has not decided, I have an obligation to get in the middle of the system to try to change it. With good reason. You look at it and say, it's corrupt. It can't be done. It has just dragged me down. We'll end with this. Guys, you can't define America for me based on ethnicity. You can't define on me based on race. You can't define based on religion. You can't define for me based on anything other than an intuitive or outward commitment to the Constitution, to the system. We're the only great nation held together by a document. Because the American people, whether they articulate it because they went to a great law school like Penn, or they are high school educated or not have a high school education, they think we mean, we hold these truths self-evident, that all men are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights. They believe it. They believe it. And now they're worried whether or not their government believes it. I spent a fair amount of time in Eastern Europe and met with a whole group of civil society people in Turkey. And they were telling me about what they were going to do and not do. And then in the Rada, in Kyiv, and throughout that area. And I say, look, here's the deal. You can't just protest. You just can't be civil society. You've got to go and run for office. You got to get your hands dirty. You got to change the system, control the levers of power, the institutional structures that uniquely hold this outfit together. And y'all can do that. You don't all have to do it, but some of you do. I really mean it. I remember I had a political theory professor at Delaware, one of the smartest guys I ever knew, and you know, you have that one person you had at school that really helped change your thinking. His name was Dr. Ingersoll. And I remember, it's nothing profound, but I remember him saying, Joe, remember what Plato said. The penalty, and he would have said it differently today, but at the time he said, the penalty good men pay for not being involved in politics is being governed by men worse than themselves. It's real basic. It ain't rocket science. You can do it.
I have a lightning round final question. Ariel Epstein, student. Ariel, are you here? There, Ariel, right here. Quick, off the top of your head answer. In a political career of over 40 years, you've been in the spotlight for a large portion of your life. What is something people still don't know about you that you wish they do? That's an original question, all right.
It is. I can think of things they know I wish they didn't. But I can't think of many things that they don't know that I wish they did. After all these years, One of my problems is I've been fairly transparent. I guess maybe it's, well, I don't think, actually, I can't think of anything that there's that they don't know about me. I used to think it was my faith because I never talked about it, but I've learned when people observing me with the death of my son and my family that they've figured that part out without my ever talking about it. But that would have been what I would have answered before. But I can't think of anything.
I think
there's a couple things you still don't really want you to know.
You're the most beloved person in public life that we know. And the final question, which you don't need to give an answer to, but it was, I swear to God, it's on that piece of paper. Was from a student who says, can I take a picture with you? And with that, you don't have to answer it.
The answer is yes, you can.
I know what the answer is, but
let us. By the way, this is about being beloved. I know better, okay? My dad had another expression. He said, don't compare me to the Almighty. Compare me to the alternative. That's the only reason I look good, the alternative.
Joe, thank you so very, very much.
Thank you all very much. I look forward to seeing a lot of you guys. Thank you. When you see me on campus, don't pretend you don't know me, all right? Thank you so very much.
That is. You're so truly enlightening.